do return them at a very high rate, and they're more likely to actually cast their ballot. So we always encourage people to vote by mail right now, and we also like the idea, people use mostly paper ballots in the state of Florida too, but in some other areas around the country, they may not be doing that. And the other thing I like about it too is it's all done on paper. You get that extra mm-hmm. security of being able to track it. And when it goes to the supervisor of elections office, when they receive it, they'll also show you online that they have received it. And so you can have security that they have received it.
I'm really jealous. I wish we had that in Wisconsin. I know actually somebody who went to vote when she was in labor because she knew that she hadn't been able to go to the early voting place. So it was like her last chance. So that would have been great. So yeah, I'm super jealous. That sounds really cool.
So Liv, is there anything else that you want to make sure that we talk about?
So I'm running to make Florida public schools number one. And that starts with creating a safe classroom environment for our students. It requires it involves making sure that we keep public school funds in public schools and not going to for-profit charter schools, and making sure we've got enough funding going to keep our classroom environments well-supplied and our teachers well-paid. One of the things that I also hear a lot from voters and parents and teachers and principals is that there's so much concern about high-stakes testing in the state of Florida. Students are spending incredible amounts of time learning how to take tests. And if on certain grades, like third grade reading, for example, third grade language arts, if they don't pass, they will be held back. They will be retained. It's a test that determines that, not an individual teacher. And so there's just incredible pressure on the students and the teachers and the parents. And some kids, I've heard from parents who say they know kids who get sick and throw up the night before. They get worried years in advance. Some cases, they know from going into first grade, if they don't start learning everything just right, they might be held back in a couple years. So there's just enormous pressure. So I'm advocating, along with some of the leading Democratic gubernatorial candidates, to back away from high-stakes testing. There's absolutely a role for testing and assessment in our classrooms, but people are teaching to the test, and everybody's getting too stressed out, and we need more room for creative work in classrooms and critical thinking and not just teaching to a test. As somebody in higher education, I'm also advocating for tuition-free community and technical college for a public two-year degrees. And this is something that we're hearing more people talk about and ask about. So many people have college debt, especially people under age 40. And the time is now. We need high-skilled labor right here in Manatee and Sarasota communities that can pay, where people can get good-paying jobs. We know there's a need for the labor. We know that young people need good-paying jobs. And this idea is not as idealistic in some ways as people might think. This is completely doable and achievable, even in this political climate. For example, the state of Tennessee, under a Republican governor and a Republican legislature with bipartisan support, actually did pass a program where people could go and get a two-year degree at a community or technical college for free. So I'd love to see Florida do something like that, too.
Yeah, and I think that might address Sophy and I are both from Ohio, and Ohio, of course, is a place where a lot of people leave after they turn 18. And I get the impression from Florida. I know a lot of people from Florida and not so many people who have stayed in Florida. And so I think that that sort of thing would also address those sorts of problems. You know, if people know they can get a degree if they stay there and get their education, then I think that could definitely address some of that.
Absolutely. We need a trained workforce right here in Florida.
Well, excellent. Thank you so much for joining us. And I love when I see people with PhDs in political science getting into running for politics. I think that this particular moment in American history is driving a lot of people who, you know, may have intended to, you know, take the more theoretical approach to politics, who are saying, no, I need to step up and run. So I'm thrilled to see you running, and we'll be watching your campaign.
Thanks so much. We've been having a lot of fun and look forward to meeting more voters.
If our listeners would like to help out with your campaign, how can they do so?
I have a website. It's www.livcoleman.com. That's L-I-V as in victory, C-O-L-E-M-A-N.com. And we have a contribute button that can go to my ActBlue page. And I'd love to have your support.
Well, thank you, Liv.
Thank you so much for having me.
Like they just hear it for the first time now. Are you la la listening? Wednesday, I am finally here with Allison Berkowitz, who is running in the Maryland House of Delegates in District 7. Hi, Allison.
Hello.
So amusingly, people had thought you had already been on the podcast, but we're finally getting you on for a conversation, and I'm so excited.
Oh, yay. Me too.
So can you start our usual first question? Tell me a little bit about your background and why you're running for the House of Delegates.
Sure. So I'm a social worker, and I've been a community organizer for about half my life. I had just moved to a different part of Maryland. And, you know, this is a very conservative area. And we were having trouble finding a Democrat to get on the ballot. So the community, I had been working on a congressional campaign for about a year. The community had asked me to run. And first, I was not very keen on the idea. I went back to school to get a doctorate so that I could be better at helping write policy, because I'm a little wonky. I think we should have more people-centered policy. So like I said, I really like the details and being a behind the scenes person. But when it became apparent that they weren't going to find anybody, and obviously these are issues that I really care about, and I obviously think, like so many people, that this is a really important time and that everyone should do their part. So after the third time I was asked, I said, okay, let's do this thing. And it's been an adventure ever since.
Great. So I'm going to need some help understanding Maryland politics. It looks a little bit like Illinois in that you've got both state houses are in Democratic control, but there's a Republican governor. In Illinois, that means that we basically have a stalemate going on all the time. I don't know what that looks like in Maryland. But what is unusual to me in understanding Maryland is the way the House of Delegates is set up seems very bizarre. There are some districts that have like an A and a B, and some where there's just two people in them. Can you explain a little bit about what's going on and what district you're running in?
Absolutely. And just want to give a preface that I've been a Marylander for a whole 2 years, so I'm not the end-all be-all, but I will tell you what I know. You know, from what I understand, it seems like we created more districts to try and be more representative, so that's why the Senate and the House districts don't line up exactly. So, for instance, my district, although it is a whole number, I do realize, yes, we do have several that are I have several, three friends running in 42B. And then, you know, I have a friend running in 34A. And so I to tell you the truth, I'm not sure why it got segmented in that way, but I suspect it just little by little has expanded to try to be more representative. And then, so our district is District 7. Like I said, we've only been, I'm not sure off the top of my head how many cycles we've been around, but not too many. It is a largely conservative area, but we have three seats. And so far, I believe all the cycles that I've looked at have been all Republicans elected, and we are not an all-Republican area. You know, a lot of people think that, but when you look at the numbers, it's a lot more purple than people realize. So to me, it makes sense that you would have at least one Democrat in one of those three seats. So I'm really hoping that when the voters go to the booth, obviously I'm knocking on every Democratic door. But in addition, I'm also appealing to Republicans and independents. And, you know, to me, it just makes sense that, you know, you have at least one of those three seats represent some of the many Democrats that we have here. So that's a little bit about the district.
So in these elections, then, it's the top three vote getters. It's not like individual people running for individual spots, but instead it's the top three vote getters who will be elected?
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Does that change anything about strategy or how you look at the election?
Yeah, I would say so. I think it gives me a lot better shot. We have three Republicans, myself, and one other Democrat who's a friend and has, you know, got on the ballot at pretty last minute for kind of strategic reasons, but that's to say he was trying to be helpful to me and to the Democratic Party. But I think it's fair to say that he would say he's not running a real campaign, a serious campaign, you know. So I think he's trying to help with the strategy. So yeah, I think, like I said, I just have to come in third. So I think that is helpful, that I'm not running for, you know, one particular seat. So like I said, we've got the three Republicans, myself, that one other Democrat I mentioned, and one person from the Green Party who acknowledges that as well, that he's kind of running more of an ideas campaign and doesn't really see himself as having too much of a shot. I don't fancy myself to have, you know, the greatest shot in the world. But I do think it's possible, and we're sure working really hard. So, like I said, I do think when you just have to come in third, I think that makes your odds quite a bit better.
And of the three Republicans who are on the ballot, only two of them are incumbents.
Exactly. Yeah. So there is one open seat. So I think that also helps the strategy a bit, makes it a little more anybody's game.
So what are the kinds of issues that you're running on in your campaign and that you're talking to people about as you go door to door?
I am a bread and butter kitchen table kind of lady. I'm talking education and healthcare and the environment and, college education, trade schools. But really, I think the biggest one that comes up the most is education. So, you know, while I am probably in my personal beliefs a bit left of center, possibly even of the Democrats in our area, I'm very pragmatic. I'm very collaborative. So I'm a person who's trying to find answers to the problems that people see here locally. So those are the main issues that I'm running on. And, you know, it seems to line up well. I haven't found, you know, like Danica Rome had, you know, the one highway. I haven't found that one District 7 issue that everybody's, you know, that's on everyone's mind. But so far, you know, I've been knocking a lot of doors and people just seem to, you know, come to the same conclusions as me that, you know, these are the most important things that are on people's minds. Everyone, and that's kind of my, you know, my deal. What I run on is that we have a lot more in common than we don't. You know, we all want roofs over our heads. We all want a good job and for our kids to go to good schools. So my slogan is that we're better together, because I believe that. So that's my hope, is trying to get people together on these, you know, these issues that I think so many of us have so much in common on.
And how are you managing to balance everything that you're doing right now? So you are a student, you are a teacher, and you're running for office. how does all that work?
Oh my goodness. That's an excellent question. I don't know. I'm doing the very best I can. No, to be honest, I think what helps is my family. My husband and his mother lives with us, and she is a doll. She helps me around the house, you know, and she helps us cook sometimes. And I really do think that's how I'm doing it, because if I had to do everything, all of the cooking and the cleaning and stuff, I don't know that I could do it. So I think they're my secret sauce, because it is a lot. I guess another thing is I'm just honest with people. Every week I have something called office hours, where I go to a different part of the district and I just hang out for 2 hours, usually a coffee shop or a restaurant, and kind of a low stakes way for people who haven't met me to come and talk. Or if we have met, but someone wants to talk about something in more depth. Sometimes I think people can be a little intimidated coming up to you at an event where there's a lot of people. So this is something that I've done and I really enjoy it, and people in the district seem to really enjoy it. But this week right now is finals week. It's the last week of my doctoral classes. It's the last week of the class I teach. So I'm just up to my elbows in papers to write and papers to grade. And I had to cancel office hours for the first time. So I just made a post and, you know, was real with people. I'm a working person just like you, and I have to meet my professional responsibilities this week. So that's another thing that I find really helpful, is I'm just honest with people. And I think maybe some people find it endearing, hopefully, that, you know, I'm just a very straightforward person and I consider myself an everyday person just like you. So I think, you know, that's one illustration of it.
The House of Delegates right now is a majority Democrat. And, you know, I don't know what the outlook looks like for this fall, whether it's projected to stay pretty blue. But are there things that you would like to see happening in the House of Delegates? Are there bills and things that you would like to see moving forward that, despite the fact that it's very blue, are not yet happening? Things, changes that you would like to bring to the office?
Absolutely.